What's up, guys? Today we're talking about the mistakes that I made in my training in the year 2018. Now, this was a few years into my training journey, but there are still a lot of problems with my training, with my technique, with a lot of the structure of my overall programming. And I want to be honest with you guys. I want to be upfront with you guys. A lot of fitness influencers, YouTubers, fitness people, they don't actually allow this kind of footage to be public. If they make any kind of mistake or they get an injury or anything happens to them or they're not fucking perfect, all that gets hushed up, gets hidden away, and they don't actually let people see that. However, a couple of reasons. First, I think this can really help people showing my mistakes and showing, you know, I'm not perfect whatsoever at all. And second of all, I think this can actually help people. You know, they can see that just because your technique isn't perfect, it doesn't mean you can't still get results, but you should always be trying to get better. And self-analysis is really the only way to actually do that. So the five biggest areas that I think I had problems with were ego lifting, range of motion, technique consistency, obviously not here, that's fucking perfection, breathing and bracing, and progression slash periodization. So let's go into the first one. The first one is ego lifting. Now, ego lifting isn't always bad. I actually did a full video on that before, but if you ego lift too much, too often, too heavy, and you allow your technique to break down, honestly, it's not a good situation, and it's going to actually lead to worse progress. There is nothing wrong with attaching some of your self-worth to your performance and results in the gym. Nothing wrong with that at all. However, if you are always chasing weight, and you probably shouldn't be, you can really set yourself up for injury, you can set yourself up for stagnation, or just not making progress in general. Sometimes you plateau. Once you're an intermediate, and certainly once you're advanced, there's gonna be some times where you just don't make progress, and you have to accept that. If you're a beginner, you can get in the idea, in the mentality, that you're always gonna make progress. Every week, you can always add weight to the bar. But all of a sudden, once you're an intermediate, that just won't be possible. And so continuing to ego lift is going to set yourself up for failure, or at least some kind of poor expectation of reality. Now, not all of the clips in this video are going to be indicative of ego lifting, but in some instances, probably like this one, you can probably tell how my form is breaking down, it's not ideal, and the tension is not going in the areas that it should be. You can see here the spinal erectors are getting a shitload of tension, clearly, and it's probably too much weight for that particular exercise. That doesn't mean I'm getting injured, but it does mean that it might lead to wear and tear on the body, plus there's really no purpose to doing that. In some of these clips, you'll see I'm doing rows, and you know, it's a very small range of motion, it's really not going to be doing much for hypertrophy, and the risk of injury does go up. Which leads me to my second point, range of motion. So as you can see here, the range of motion is not very high, and this isn't necessarily always a bad thing. But if you're always chasing reduced range of motion just to move more weight, as in this case, honestly, if your goal is strength or hypertrophy, that's probably not necessarily a good thing. So use the correct range of motion. Try to keep your technique as standard as possible, which leads me to point number three, technique and consistency. Now, this was a big one. My technique was all over the place. Sometimes I was using less range of motion, as I just said before, sometimes more range of motion, sometimes cheating reps, sometimes not cheating reps, and I really was just all over the place with my technique because I was chasing weight too much. Now, I undoubtedly did get stronger during this year. In fact, I got pretty good results from doing this style of training, but I don't think it is sustainable in the long term. And there wasn't really a good reason to justify this. If you try to step outside your own brain and you try to self-assess in a logical and fair manner, a lot of what I was doing in the weight room just didn't make any sense. You know, if a clone of myself asked me and said, "Geoff, what the fuck are you doing?" I probably couldn't give a reasonable and honest explanation. It was basically just stuff I wanted to do. And while you should enjoy your training, and you should also try to get as strong as possible, there are other factors like technique, like just feeling the movement, getting better, being able to activate a certain muscle. And you don't have to go to like only using isolation movements, but you should always be aiming to maximize your technique first. You know, you can use the same weight two sessions in a row. There's nothing wrong with that, especially if you feel better and more confident the second time. If you use 100 kilos in the squat week one, you don't have to go up to get progressive overload. You can use more reps, and even if you use the same number of reps, the same sets, the same weight, the same everything on paper, if you feel better, if you feel more confident, more controlled, if the RPE is down, that is still a form of progression. However, I never really allowed my strength to consolidate. And that is something that I think is really important. You know, you feel a certain weight and it feels a little bit difficult at first, a little bit dangerous. You're unsure. You're not sure how many reps you can get. And then over time, you establish a baseline of performance while getting better technique over time. And I think that is key. And that is something that I wasn't really doing during this year. I was just always chasing more weight, more weight, more weight, getting PRs, and I was hitting PRs during this time, but you have to ask yourself, at what cost? Because hitting a PR is good, but if you hit a PR and you didn't really earn it, or if the technique was not good at all, maybe it's not worth it. And maybe you should pull back from that PR and wait a little bit, hit a purposeful plateau until your technique consolidates. I think that's a better way to go about things. And it leads to a more sustainable outcome. The next one is going to be breathing and bracing. And this is something I didn't really do very well. I didn't really think about it. I didn't even know this was a thing. To me, it was just bend over and lift up the weight, or put the weight on your back and then squat down and hopefully you stand up. But it led to really, really inconsistent results. And while I didn't get injured, I think injury was definitely a possibility, and I avoided injury mostly just through having strong spinal erectors, as you can see right there, and maybe just luck, you know, having a naturally stronger spine or something, I don't know. But I think for most people, if they lift in this manner, as you see here, I think they'll get injured, and I think learning how to breathe and brace is absolutely essential. As you can see here, the technique is better on that squat, even though the weight was exactly the same. And that's what I'm talking about in terms of consolidating your technique. It's not just getting stronger, it's moving better and moving in a way that is conducive towards long-term sustainable results. Now, in terms of breathing and bracing, the best resource that I have found is Alexander Bromley. He has a free ebook that it's actually free. It's not like input your email and I'll spam you full of products free. It's actually free. You just go there and you download it, check out his YouTube, and there's my wife. But you can go and you can get this free ebook, which I think is really, really a great resource and really taught me a lot. It's essential to learn how to brace. You need to know how to do it. And if you don't know how to do it, even if you use a belt, you will probably still eventually have some issues. So either learn how to brace or don't lift weights, basically. And even if you don't lift weights, if you don't know how to brace, you're still probably going to eventually hurt yourself when you're picking up a suitcase or something. It is that important. And number five is going to be progression and periodization. Basically, I did not have any kind of either. I didn't have any kind of progression. I would basically just pick a movement and do it. And it would be different every time. Occasionally, I would do the same movement a few times in a row. Often what I would do is I would do a movement day one, and then I would get so excited about the movement, I would get so, you know, obsessed with this movement that I would do it for like a whole week straight. I would, you know, high bar back squat day one, day two, day three, day four, day five, and then I would just be wrecked, and then I wouldn't do it for a month. And that was basically my periodization. That is a stupid way to periodize, because obviously you cannot really recover, especially if you're doing a lot of sets, and I was. You can maybe still get some results doing this, but it is definitely far from optimal. This was basically a phase where I was constantly experimenting in my training, and there's nothing wrong with doing that, but with any experiment, you need to change small things. If you change the entire experiment, it is no longer an experiment, it's just a scientist throwing shit around in a laboratory and you're not even measuring anything, because how can you measure something when all of the variables are always changing? You should change one variable at a time, maybe two. But even if you change only two, which is, you know, more than you probably should, you still don't know which variable it was. If you up your volume and then you also lower your frequency, you don't necessarily know which is going to cause a better or worse result. It could be the volume, it could be the frequency, it could be the interaction, it could be something else entirely. You just don't know. And I wasn't just changing two variables, I was changing 10 variables or 20 variables. I was changing everything up every single workout. And this is why you see these clips. These are in order chronologically. This is like most of the workouts that I did in 2018. And you can see there's really no pattern. There's like random deadlifts and then other deadlifts and then some random presses and then some bench presses and then some rows and then some cleans and then some farmer's walks. It's really just all over the place. And most of the exercises are selected with very little rhyme or reason or logic or anything at all. They are just chosen because I saw them on YouTube and I wanted to try them out. That's not a good way to get better. That's a good way to try a bunch of exercises, but in terms of actually improving a bunch of exercises or improving your strength or improving your hypertrophy or getting lean, it is probably not optimal. Now, despite all of that, the ego lifting range of motion, the technique, the breathing, the bracing inconsistency, the poor progression and no periodization, as you can see, I'm getting pretty decent results. You can basically see me getting bigger over time. And this was after, you know, 3 or 4 years of already training. So this is a pretty good result. And this shows that even if your training is not optimal or downright stupid, you can still make progress if you stay healthy. So if you are fairly durable, as I was and sort of still am, you can still get away with a lot of stuff. But in terms of longevity, I don't really advise training like this because you can develop issues down the road. So if I had to change something, I would change all of those. I wouldn't ego lift. I would use full or at least consistent range of motion. My technique would always be the same and I would really focus on always doing it the right way. I would learn to breathe and brace from the start with the very, very basic movements. I would probably incorporate more abdominal direct exercises as well. And I would focus on mapping out my training in a more consistent and periodized manner, which wasn't just training ADD, doing whatever I wanted to on that day or week. You really do want to plan your training out months in advance, ideally, in order to get optimal results, or at least have some kind of clear vision about what you want to do with your physique. So learn from my mistakes rather than your own mistakes. It's always better to learn from someone else's mistakes, and that's why I'm putting out this video. So I hope it helps, and I hope it can steer you to the path of truth and glory. That's all for this video, and I'll see you in the next one. Peace! There once was a man from Shenzhen who reviewed his old training and then saw so many mistakes that whatever it takes, he had to share with his friends.